Welcome, brothers and sisters, to our Wednesday Bible study. Let us open our hearts and let us worship our Lord. Let's invite the Holy Spirit to come into this place, to come into our hearts. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. We welcome your presence. We welcome your anointing tonight, Lord. Worship you. There's nothing worth more than we'll ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence.
Spirit, you are welcome. flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. God, flood this place and fill the
Jesus, beautiful, eternal King, you will reign forever. Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his life. We thank you for his sacrifice. More than anything else, we thank you for your love for us. We receive your love, we receive your plans, we receive your blessings, and we receive your call upon our lives. Prepare us. Prepare us for the path of providence, for the path of purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Part 13 in our series, Practical Wisdom for Purposeful Living. From the book of Proverbs, verse 16. I believe God puts us on a path of providence. It's a path full of purpose, and most important thing for us is to know that there's purpose in our life, but then we need to prepare for it. We can't sit around and do nothing about it. In Proverbs 16, it says, the preparations of the heart belong to men, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. So I want to begin by saying that preparation, good preparation, is everything. Good preparation is everything. Knowing that we have a call, knowing that there's a path, knowing that there's a purpose, and what that purpose may be is important, but then we need to be prepared for it. So preparation is your responsibility. God gives us the purpose. He gives us the plan. We have to prepare our whole being, our heart, soul, spirit, our arms, our legs, our whole life has to be filled with that purpose. God is preparing you for the things He has prepared for you. You need to prepare yourself for the things that He has planned and prepared for you. Some would say, aren't they the same thing? Yes, God's preparation is God's preparation. But doesn't mean that all of us are open and prepared for it. He has prepared an abundant life for you. He has prepared a purposeful life for you. But then you need to lay hold of it and to walk in it and to prepare your entire being to fulfill it. The problem is that pride gets in the way of God's plans. Pride always rears its ugly head. In verse 5 of Proverbs 16, it says, everyone proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Though they join forces, none will go unpunished. I mean, the word of God is pretty strong here. It says that pride is an abomination. But how does pride get in the way of God's plans for your life? Just think for a moment the different ways that pride trips us up. I guess one of the greatest reasons why pride gets in the way of God's plan is in our lives is because we probably think that we have a better plan, that we're smart enough, good enough, And then when God comes along with his plans, our pride says, well, I want to do it my way. So get rid of pride before it gets a hold of you. Get rid of pride before it gets in the way of God's plan for your life. In verse 18 and 19, it says, pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. Better to be of a humble spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud. Proverbs 15:22 says, without counsel, plans go awry, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established. So I would say, if you want God's plans to be fulfilled in your life, then seek godly counsel. Be ready to discard your own plans. Humbly approach God and the elders and those that know the way and the word of God. The sad thing is that many people only seek godly counsel to endorse, to bless their own plans, their own unworkable and godly plans sometimes. They say, God, this is my plan, bless it. But that's not how it works, because God has his own plan. And often they only come for counsel after they have put their own plans into action and perhaps it falls apart. So be humble. Be ready to change your own plans in preference of God's. Be thankful and hold off on putting your own plans into action until you know what God's plan is. Point three, pray before you plan. Part of the preparation is not just getting pride out of the way, but praying, asking God. Don't just go ahead and do it. Don't just go ahead and put everything into motion. Pray. If God already has a plan for me, then why should I pray? Shouldn't I just jump in and assume that this my plan is his plan? And this is where presumption can get us into problems. And we need to pray. We need to talk to him. We need to have open channels of communication so that he can tell us. He can guide us. He can redirect our paths. Should we stray from the path? We need to pray about our part in the plan of God. Don't assume. Don't presume to know God's ways. Often we fail because we presume too much. The truth is many don't see God's plan fulfilled in their lives because they have a mind of their own. And their plans are short-sighted, short-lived. And often even when God reveals that those are not the plans of God, they don't want to disown it, they don't want to chuck it aside, because perhaps they have invested too much into their own plans and lives. And this way in verse 25, the very popular verse of Proverbs 16:25, there is a way that seems right to a man. It only seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. So don't do what seems right. Do what God says is right. And verse 3 of that same chapter says, commit your works to the Lord, and your thoughts will be established. God speaks through your mind. Do you know that? But he only speaks if we're willing to hear. He only speaks if we would commit, meaning bring it before God. Let him review it. Let him redraft it. Let him retweak it. Whatever way you want to put it, let God have that first right to change and to do what he does best in terms of plans. So make sure your mind is tuned to the word. Make sure your mind is tuned to the word and the words of God. Because Isaiah says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. That's what God is saying, that he's so far beyond us in terms of his planning, his thoughts, his way of doing things, that we need to be so careful to tune in, to set aside time, to adjust everything so that we can accommodate God and assimilate his ways. So the discussion here is to share about some plans that fail in your life. Perhaps you planned a lot of good things, a lot of great things in your life, but share some of those plans that failed. Perhaps you had a plan to be a movie star, you had a plan to be a rich man, you had a plan to be a great missionary, whatever plans it may be. You know, why did they fail? What kind of preparations would you focus on in your future plans now that you look back in hindsight at some of your failed plans. Let's move on to point B. Godly planning ensures great results. And I want to stress godly planning, not your own planning. So godly planning ensures great results in your life. Planning isn't everything. Godly planning is. Let me stress that again. It's not just planning. It's godly planning that matters. Proverbs 19:21, it says, there are many plans in a man's heart. I have many plans. You know, I have a lot of plans to do God's work. But it doesn't mean that because it's God's work that he will say, yes, go with everything that, you know, it has to be God's plan. There are many plans in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the Lord's counsel that will stand. It is the Lord's counsel. It is the Lord's ways. It is his own time, his own place, his own people. When he puts it all together, that will work. So you cannot get God's plan if you are not used to his ways. You've got to get used to God's ways. God has a certain way of doing things. You know, if you walked with God a long time, you know that God's ways are very often not man's ways. He does things so differently. You know, just when you don't expect it, God does it that way. Just when you don't think it'll come from that place, the blessings come from that place. That's God. You know, he's full of surprises. And that's the reason why we need to be so open and ready for God. A man's heart plans his ways, but the Lord directs his steps. You can plan, but even the direction of your steps comes from God. It is the pleasure and the purpose of God for one's plans to succeed. Our plans must always be under the divine will of God. And not only that, our plans have to be directed step by step by from Him. So make sure that your motives are pure. You know, godly planning involves godly motives too. Verse 2 of the same chapter, all the ways of a man are pure in his own eyes, but the Lord weighs the spirit. You know, I've heard so many people come up to me and say, you know, Pastor, can you pray for me? I've got this business. I want to start this work, or I want to do this, I have these plans for my children, and if God blesses them, then I will do this for God. As if, you know, God can be bribed. You know, and I hear that so often that sometimes, you know, it breaks my heart. You know, are we trying to gain God's favor? Or are we trying to bribe Him by saying, if you bless me, I will give you so much? God doesn't need that. He looks at our motives. We may look at it and we may think, wow, what a pure heart. You know, I'm going to do this for God. We may fool ourselves, but God sees everything. So make sure your motives are pure. And of course, from verse 33, there's no such thing as luck. It has to do with the Lord. It's not a matter of just trying this, trying that, and hopefully you'll be lucky. You know, and verse 33 puts it very well. The lot is cast into the lap, but it's every decision is from the Lord. It's not the roll of the dice that determines your fate. It is God. Know that. You know, it's not lucky number 8. It is God who determines our everyday. So let's go to the discussion again. How do I get used to God's higher ways? Have you ever thought about that? Since God's ways and thoughts are higher than ours, how do you get used to it? How do you tune in? Read Matthew 6:33. Discuss how Matthew 33 affects your motives in life. Seek first the kingdom of God. Let's move on to point C. Preparation, pray, godly planning, then get positioned in the path of God's providential path. You've got to position yourself. Yes, you've got to prepare, you've got to pray, you've got to make sure it's God's plan and follow it, but then you need to position yourself. What do I mean by that? If God is behind every blessed plan, then you need to position yourself in the right place, at the right time, at the right moment, the right attitude, doing the right thing with the right heart. I mean, you read the Bible and you realize that every man, woman of God, when God came into your life, they were at a specific place, at a specific time of their lives. If they had not been there, if they had been in a different place doing a different thing, they might have missed the plan of God in their lives. Think about Moses, if his mother had not placed him in that woven basket and put him in the river Nile at that time, that place where the tide was moving in a certain direction, he would have not ended up in Pharaoh's palace. He might have ended up eaten by crocodiles or dead. So positioning yourself is important, and that's where we need to be led of God. How do you position yourself in all these different areas? Do what you know will please God. What pleases God? Don't just do what pleases you. Don't just do what is convenient. Don't just do what profits your family, yourself. Do what pleases God, and you'll never be wrong. That's a proper position to be found if you want to find favor with God. The Lord has made all for himself. In verse 4, it says, yes, even the wicked for the day of doom. In mercy and truth, atonement is provided for iniquity. And by the fear of the Lord, one departs from evil. Verse 7 says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. Better is a little with righteousness than vast revenues without justice. Tie in verse 7 and 8. When a man's way please the Lord, better is a little with righteousness. How do we please God? A righteous lifestyle. Doing things righteously to please God, to honor him. Two, we need to find favor. Finding favor is the best position you can be in. Of course, you know, please God and then finding favor. It's important as you read the Bible again that when you put yourself in the right place with the right attitude and motivation to please God, that you will find favor with God. And when you find favor with God, you find favor with men. Again, that's in the Bible. Look at Joseph. He found favor with God. He found favor with Potiphar. He found favor with God. He found favor with the jailer. He found favor with God. He found favor with Pharaoh. Likewise for you. And then point three, stay on the highway of the upright. Verse 16 says, how much better to get wisdom than gold, and to get understanding is to be chosen rather than silver. Verse 17, this is where I get that phrase. The highway of the upright is to depart from evil. He who keeps his way preserves his soul. He who heeds the word wisely will find good. That's the place you want to be found. That's the path of God. It's called the highway of the upright. And I want to be on the highway. I want to be the highway of pleasing God, of finding favor with him and people around him, but the highway of righteousness, of walking by his word step by step. And that highway leads us from beginning to the end of our life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of our lives. If you walk on the highway of the upright. And the final discussion, where are you right now in the path of God's plan? Are you on the highway of the upright? Where are you in terms of preparation, your prayer, your planning with God? And where are you positioned right now? Are you right in the center of God's will? Or are you struggling, swimming on the fringes, you know, wandering off the path of God? So what are some of the signs that you are not on the right path? Do you get a voice? Do you see flashing lights? What are some of the signs? What should you do when you realize that you have wandered off the path? So I would urge you, stay on the highway of the upright, because God has a path of providence and purpose for you. May God bless you, and we ask you to continue again to join us Sunday after Sunday. Join us for our Zoom right before our Sunday services online. And we love to connect with you. We want to pray for you. Continue to pray for all those that have been exposed to the virus and those that have actually been tested positive. That God will heal and touch their bodies. Let me bless you before we go. Father, I pray, O God, that you touch all those that are sick, O God, and those that have caught the virus. I pray that you heal them, deliver them, and Lord, give them great health again. And Lord, direct each one of us on the path, on the highway of the upright. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.